1 Corinthians chapter 2, and you'll notice on the dry erase board behind me, the title for this morning's lesson is The Lord of Glory. And yet what I hope we'll be able to achieve this morning is looking at a fascinating aspect of the glory that the Apostle Paul here is referring to in connection to that title, The Lord of Glory. And the passage that we'll be looking at is here, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, beginning at verse 6 and reading on down through verse 8. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, beginning at verse 6, "Howbeit, we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom, which God ordained before the world unto our glory." We're going to look specifically at what exactly is Paul getting at here. Verse 8, "which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory." Our Heavenly Father, again, we thank you for your wisdom. We thank you for the revelation of the mystery, that hidden information that you kept secret in and through yourself. And we just thank you that as we now can study it, we can learn about the glorious details, how it is we as members of the body of Christ are going to eternally participate the glory of the outworking of your eternal purpose. We pray that our time together in study of your word, as always, would prove to be enlightening and edifying. And we do, of course, ask in Christ Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. The Apostle Paul here uses a title which is quite unique in the epistles of Paul. And what we're also going to discover is that the Apostle Paul here, he's going to borrow language from the Old Testament, specifically Psalms chapter 24. But we're going to look at what it means for the Lord Jesus specifically to be called the Lord of glory and the correlation between his person and the fact that we are involved in a type of glory. The very end of verse 7, "which God ordained before the world," now notice, "unto our glory." So we find this correlation between our glory, and that means corporately who we are as this new creature, members of the church, the body of Christ. God ordained something for us and on our behalf that results in the glorification of the believer, and it has something to do with the Lord of glory. When we study the word glory, there are different types of glory in the Bible. Of course, the most well-known type of glory would be the visible, physical manifestation of course, God's presence. In the Old Testament, it was called the Shekinah glory. And there were many times in which God, Jehovah, when he would visibly appear, there was this manifestation of light. There was this manifestation of some form of illumination. So we're very familiar with that first type of glory described in the Bible, which has everything to do with the literal, physical, visible manifestation of the presence of Almighty God. But then there's another way in which we understand glory in the Bible, and it isn't limited to the literal, visible, physical manifestation of the presence of God, but there's a type of glory that has to do with the moral, intellectual, invisible, spiritual manifestation of the appearance of God. See, God can choose to reveal himself in many different ways. Obviously, he did reveal himself in a physical form, the Shekinah glory. But God's glory is also manifested when he reveals some things about his wisdom. By the way, in the context, that's the type of glory that the Apostle Paul here is addressing. Notice again verse 6, "howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect," and I flesh, do you understand? When the Apostle Paul uses the language, them that are perfect, he's not talking about those individuals who are sinlessly perfect, but rather it's a reference to individuals, believers, members of the body of Christ, that are operating at a higher level of spiritual maturity, spiritual growth, spiritual development. The Corinthians are still in the infant stage. You know, we walk into the church building and you have the nursery. The first room that you see is the nursery. Well, sadly, the Corinthians, they were still operating on the milk doctrines. And so the Apostle Paul, he's rebuking. By the way, what Paul is doing here is he's rebuking the Corinthians. These saints at Corinth should have been at a level of spirituality where they should have been able to take some of the meat doctrine of Paul's revelation. And so what Paul is saying is, I can't do that. Because the information, this hidden wisdom of God, this system of information entrusted to the Apostle Paul, isn't easily digestible with spiritual babes, with spiritual infants, because there is the need for proper growth and development, so on and so forth. So Paul, he's referring to specifically this wisdom. Verse 7, we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom. So, and then at the end of verse 8, of course, the Lord of glory. So there's an aspect regarding the glory of the Lord that isn't referring to, again, the visible manifestation of who he is, but it is referring to the invisible aspect of his person, okay? Specifically, the appearance of his wise purpose and plan, not only for the universe at large, but his wise purpose and plan for each and every one of us, by virtue of the fact that we're part of his new creature created in Christ Jesus. So that's another way in which glory is used in the Bible. There's another way in which glory is used in the Bible. When one bestows great honor, great blessing, when someone bestows praise on someone else, that's referred to as glory. When you bless someone and you honor them with riches, that's glory. Then there's another type of glory. When someone sees the benefit or the advantage of something, when someone sees the profit of someone, of something, that also is glorying. Remember how Paul, he says, I glory in mine infirmities. Now, not a one of us rejoices in infirmities. And by the way, when Paul talks about glorying in infirmities, he's not talking about COVID, the cold, the flu, or physical ailment. He's actually talking about the work of the ministry, as we read about it in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. But my point is this, in what way or in what sense can Paul say, I glory in mine infirmities? He didn't enjoy it. None of us enjoy it. But rather, we can choose to see the spiritual advantage and benefit in infirmities. And that's what Paul is doing, for example, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, when he talks about, I would rather glory in mine infirmities. Because as a well-educated believer, we're never frightened by tribulation or persecution. We know something, I hope, if we've graduated from the book of Romans. Tribulation worketh patience. Patience, experience, and experience, hope, and hope maketh not ashamed. In that sense, Paul says, I see the spiritual value, and I see the spiritual profit. That might mean physically life might be very difficult. And there might be, and there certainly will be, obstacles and distractions and opposition and so on and so forth. But the perspective of a believer is this: bad things in life are not our enemy anymore. Isn't that interesting? Tribulation is not our enemy. Persecution, opposition, it's not our enemy. we recognize tribulation works. It is actually to our benefit and to our spiritual advantage. That's why Paul could write, "Our light affliction, which is but for a moment." Now, I know when we're going through difficult times, doesn't it seem like time slows down? But as far as God's concerned, listen, our time here on earth, 60, 70, 80, for Kathy, 55 years, that's all the time she had. And if you're fortunate enough to live to be 100, as long as you retain your sanity, I don't want to live to be 100 if I lose my mind. You know what? God says, it's but for a moment, but that affliction, the light affliction, worketh for us a far greater and eternal weight of what glory. See, so there's the perspective of the believer. Again, you have the physical manifestation of the appearance of Almighty God, quote, Shekinah glory. You have the wise plan of Almighty God, the spiritual revelation and manifestation of who He is, His character, His attributes. Again, those are, quote, invisible, but they are visible as we study the Word of God. The eyes of our understanding being enlightened. There is the sense in which glory has to do with bestowing riches and blessing and honor to an individual. There's the type of glory in which, again, we see the benefit and the advantage of circumstances and situations. And then there's another type of glory, which also has something to do with the Apostle Paul here in the end of verse 7. Read the end of verse 7 again. Which God ordained before the world unto our what? Glory. That type of glory has to do with being the object of someone's awe. Being the object of splendor. Have you ever marveled at something? You know, when I was stationed in Alaska, on top of a mountain, radar sight, Air Force. You've heard of the Aurora Borealis, right? The Northern Lights. Now, we don't always get to see the, quote, Northern Lights around here. I was stationed in Duluth, Minnesota. For some reason, the Air Force thought it wasn't cold enough, so now you're going to Alaska. But if you've ever been to Alaska, and we were north of Fairbanks, and it is one of the most spectacular experiences when you know, in Minnesota, you look to the north and you would see the lights, you know. When you're in Alaska, you're literally looking directly overhead. And these lights, you have the dancing green and yellow and orange and white. And I'm standing there on top of that mountain, and I'm just awed by the splendor of God's creation. It's beautiful. It wreaked havoc to the radar system, but that's another story. But the point is this, we can appreciate the magnitude of something. You understand that you and I are created to be the trophies of God's grace. You know what God's doing with us as He's forming this new entity, the church, the body of Christ, created in Christ Jesus? We are now the object of awe and splendor. Not because we earned it. Listen, me, my life, my activities, there is nothing to glory in. I'm not awed by a whole lot of people here. And that isn't the point here. But when we recognize what God is doing with the believer, He wants to put on display for the entire universe, for the entire creation. He's putting on display the magnitude, the depth of the riches of His grace, where God can take something that was literally of no value, no profit. We were made, we were originally material that was useless to Almighty God while we were dead in trespasses and sins. And guess what God can do? Take that material that is lifeless, dead, and impart life. And impart the righteousness of His Son. And deposit the riches of His glory so that the creation now, they can recognize the handiwork of God, and I'm not just talking about physical creation, they can recognize this new creature, and we now are the very objects of God's splendor and awe. Not because we did a single thing, but because He's done it all for us on the behalf of His beloved Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And I want to show you something here. Any of you ever saw the movie Glory? Remember the movie Glory? By the way, it was Veterans Day on Thursday, right? Yes, and you know, thank you for your service, and so on and so forth. And so, of course, I'm your typical, stereotypical male. I strip the remote control from the hands of my wife, and I look for a war movie. I don't know what it is. I like war movies. So anyway, I have my top 10, maybe my top 3 war movies, okay? I think probably my second most favorite war movie was Glory. And I don't know if you've ever seen Glory. It's based on a true story, by the way. Now, the movie came out in 1989 or whatever it was. Anyway, the movie Glory was a true story about the 54th Massachusetts Regiment. It was an all-black volunteer regiment, Union soldiers. And you think, why was the movie named Glory when that significant battle, and if you study history back in July of 1869, the Union Army, they launched an assault against Fort Wagner, Morris Island, south of Charleston, South Carolina, okay? And they sent thousands of troops. This is the first time the all-black volunteer regiment are engaged in an assault. In fact, they were one of the first units that charged uphill. Now, if you know anything about war strategy, you don't want to initiate an assault on a fort on a hill. You're doomed. So the sad reality of that assault, half of the regiment were either wounded, captured, or killed. But what made... So you think about it. Wait a minute. Is there glory in defeat? Now, we understand one battle does not a war make. We understand all of that, okay? What was it about the 54th Massachusetts Regiment? You've got to understand something about the history of that unit. Both the Union Army as well as the Confederates. You know what they thought about the black soldier? They deemed the black soldier as inferior. They were discarded. They were ridiculed. There was a fear that the black soldier would be disloyal, that they would be frightened. They lacked the courage. They lacked the intelligence. And yet what this unit did, the 54th, they not only fought, they fought hard, and they fought to the death. They fought for freedom, and they fought for country. Here's why the movie was titled Glory. Now, wait a minute. They lost. In fact, the Union Army, they lost 1,500 men. It was a bloody... These guys charged the hill in the face of withering fire. Absolute bloodshed. Glory. You know, that battle was, according to historians, it turned the tide of the Civil War. You know why? As a result of the bravery and the loyalty and the courage of these black soldiers, it completely changed the view that both the Union and the Confederate leaders had about the black soldier. After that battle, 180,000 black men volunteered to fight for the Union Army. Historians said that changed the tide of the Civil War. Glory. Now, I want you to hold that thought, because when we examine what God is doing, verse 7, with the end of verse 7, which God ordained before the world unto our glory, and who's responsible for all of that? The end of verse 8, the Lord of who, of what? Glory. You know what God did? Glance back to chapter 1 and notice there verse 25. Chapter 1. and verse 25. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called, but God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. And base things of the world and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. Listen, you better not be dazzled by your own importance. You better not be overwhelmed by your own awesomeness. What God chooses, the Lord of glory proves who he is as a wise God. And by the way, Paul uses the language, to God only wise be the glory. Because God doesn't take the rich, the powerful. You know what he does? He takes the dregs of humanity. And by the way, that's each and every one of us. And when Paul, by the way, here he writes about, you see your call, he's not saying that God only saves people. No, you see, the Corinthians, they were falling victim to the lie that, you know, the world has a whole lot to offer. You know, the wisdom of the world, so on and so forth, okay? What I'm getting at is this. When God ordains something to our glory, because he's the Lord of glory, he proves who he is and the capacity and what constitutes his thinking. He takes the undesirables. He takes the expendables. He takes those who are, as Paul would describe, the offscouring of the world. People who are dismissed. People who are discarded. That's where you and I come in. I qualify. And God says, I can do so. I can take you and make you an object of my, a trophy of my grace. There's only one other time that we find that title, the Lord of glory. Now, Paul uses it in verse 8 of chapter 2. James is the only other writer who uses the title Lord of glory. I want to turn there quickly and just notice when James, he uses that title, and let's recognize the context in which he makes the reference to, quote, the Lord of glory. James chapter 2. And notice there, verse 1. James chapter 2, verse 1. My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, notice, the Lord of glory. Why is he calling him the Lord of glory? As we keep reading, we'll get a handle on what the use of the term Lord of glory. Remember, there are many types of glory. What James is referring to, what the Apostle Paul is referring to, is something unseen. Not the literal, visible, physical manifestation of the person of Almighty God, but rather the invisible spiritual manifestation of his ultimate wisdom. So notice what James does. Again, verse 1, my brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of who? Persons. That's why James is appealing to that title, the Lord of glory. When it comes to the way we perceive one another, when it comes to the way we evaluate people, remember something about the Lord of glory. The Lord of glory does not take into consideration, he, as the verse says, God is not a respecter of persons. Now, what does that mean? God doesn't take into consideration who we are in the capacity or capacities of our flesh. God does not respect anything that we bring to the altar of Calvary. We come broken, naked, destitute. We come in that urgent condition that we find ourselves in. While we were yet sinners, while we were yet ungodly, while we were enemies. There is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that doeth good. While we were dead in trespasses and sins, when we approach God, we don't bring anything, nor do we contribute to His work of grace that is put on open display when He spared not His Son and put Him to death for each and every one of us. And for anyone to think, well, surely He'll respect my sincerity. Nope. Well, He ought to respect my good work. Nope. He'll respect my religiosity. Nope. He doesn't respect anything that humanity would dare offer. I love what Brother Pastor Russ Hargett said years ago. He said, the only thing we can ever contribute in our salvation, in our eternal redemption, is our sin. Because God did it all on our behalf. So now, appreciate what James is doing here. The Lord of glory, He doesn't respect persons, and there's a danger for the believer to begin to what? Respect people based upon who they are, based upon their social status, based upon their economic standing, based upon their popularity, based upon all of their charisma. And so James, when he's referring to the Lord of glory, there's something not right when he's writing to the 12 tribes of Israel. He's not writing directly to the church of the body of Christ, but he's using the same language, the same title Paul is using. Verse 2, for if there come unto your assembly a man with a gold ring in goodly apparel, and there come in also a poor man in vile raiment, and ye have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing, and say unto him, sit thou here in a good place, and say to the poor, stand thou there, or sit here under my footstool. Are ye not then partial in yourselves, and are become judges of evil thoughts? The Lord of glory, that's not what He does. He doesn't respect anything that we might have to offer. But rather, He rejoices in the manifestation of His ability and capacity to take that which is unprofitable and ordain glory. You see, just like the 54th Regiment, discarded, they were discredited, they were expendable, they were ignored, they can't do it. And yet, glory, they did it. They lost, but who ultimately wins? The Union Army ultimately won. There's a fascinating parallel here. Now, when we study who we once were, go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, okay? 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Let's do this. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and let's go to Psalms chapter 24, because Paul, he's doing something here. He's borrowing language from the Old Testament. If we notice in Psalms chapter 24, and we're not going to be looking at Psalms chapter 24 in any great detail, but let's look at the passage in Psalms chapter 24, okay? The language that Paul is borrowing, if I could say that, is actually found in Psalms chapter 24, Verse 8, we should read verse 7. Let's read Psalms chapter 24, verses 7 through verse 10. Psalms 24, verse 7. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. The Apostle Paul never calls Jesus Christ the King of glory. In fact, there's something real interesting in Paul's epistles. Paul wrote 13 letters, Romans through Philemon, and he only refers to the Lord Jesus Christ as King twice. Three times. But he never refers to the Lord Jesus Christ in relationship to His messianic title, King of Glory. Rather, Paul uses the title Lord of Glory. He's going to add something to what we are reading about, for example, in Psalms chapter 24. He's going to add something about the capacities of the Lord Jesus Christ, something that he did which was ordained before the world unto our glory, that is, to be the very object of wonder, splendor, and marvel. Not because we did it, because of what he's doing and what he's done. So that's an interesting study. Now, we're not going to go there. When Paul does refer to Jesus Christ as king, for example, in 1 Timothy chapter 1, 1 Timothy chapter 6, when he refers to the Lord Jesus as king, it's not in connection to the ultimate messianic title when Christ is going to establish his kingdom on the earth. Chapter 24 of Psalms is all yet future. It has as its focus the millennial reign of Jesus Christ on the earth, okay? In fact, the title, King of Glory, has everything to do with the second coming. It has to do with the kingdom of the King, Jesus Christ. Paul never refers to him in that way. When Paul does refer to Jesus as king, he's referring to the fact that the Davidic covenant stipulates for resurrection. So when Paul does refer to the king, by the way, he doesn't go around saying King Jesus. You'll hear that quite often. Evangelical groups, you know, they'll say King Jesus. Be careful with that. Paul never calls him, quote, King Jesus. But when Paul does refer to Jesus Christ as king, it's the fact that the fulfillment of the Davidic covenant only is possible through the promise of resurrection. He's the king who is immortal. Paul says it twice. And then he says, King of kings, Lord of lords. So that's why, that's the only time Paul refers to Jesus as king. Because he was resurrected for the purpose of fulfilling the Davidic covenant. His resurrection is our resurrection. So just always keep that in mind. Verse 7 of Psalms 24, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord, Jehovah of hosts. He is the King of glory, Selah. He's coming. This is a second coming passage. The fulfillment of the messianic hope and promise is vested in the King of glory, which will literally be visibly manifested materially and physically when he is sitting on the throne of glory in Jerusalem. But that hasn't happened yet. When you study Psalms chapter 24, you can outline it this way. There are four sections to chapter 24. The reason I want you to be aware of the four sections is because we find the same parallel when Paul writes to the Corinthians. The first verse, notice chapter 24, verse 1. We find the place of Israel's future hope. Where is the place of Israel's future hope? Verse 1, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. I can't get over the word fullness. I learned something fascinating over the summer. And notice, the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Do you notice how the fullness of the earth and they that dwell are separated? Those are two different things here. Now, when we think about the fullness of the earth, you know, we think about the rocks, the plants, the trees, the flowers, so on and so forth. When we think about the fullness, that would include anything on the planet belongs to God. When God created, he created it for himself. The Apostle Paul in Colossians, it describes how Jesus Christ, he created all things. All things were created by him. And what else? For him. God created humanity for himself. You know what sin is? You know the middle letter of sin, right? I. That independent spirit that is the hallmark characteristic of the human experience is this willful rebellion and resistance towards the one who created you. God didn't create humanity so that humanity can just go ahead and, quote, do whatever they want. He created humanity for himself. So you think about why God even created. Well, when God, the Lord Jesus, created the earth, everything belongs to him and the fullness thereof. Anything that the planet Earth contains belongs to him. But the word fullness isn't just limited to that which is existent at any moment of time. Now, it belongs to him. By the way, that doesn't mean he's in operational control. If we have time, we're going to see some things here. There's an issue here in the passage regarding the Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. See, Paul's going to expand on some of this in his epistles. But my point for right now is, so here you have Jesus Christ. He created all things. The fullness, it belongs to him. But he's not in operational control. Jesus Christ is not exercising governmental control of the world. And we'll see that. Now, there is an adversary who is exercising governmental control. But it isn't Jesus yet. It won't happen until this chapter is fulfilled. But the fullness, that isn't just limited to something existent at any moment in time, but it also includes any and all potentiality. Just think about this. How many of you perhaps have a garden and you have maybe a fruit tree? I'm going to use the apple tree as an example, right? You have one apple tree. You can rightly say, anything in that garden belongs to me and the fullness thereof. Does that apple tree belong to you? Yeah. So let's say the apple tree produces 10 apples. Would those 10 apples belong to you? If you own the garden and the fullness thereof. I own not only the singular apple tree, but if that tree produces 10 apples, guess what? The fullness of the apple tree, that belongs to me as well. But if one apple can produce 100 apple trees, well, would the fullness of the first apple tree who produces the apple who produces 10 more or 100 more apples? You see how exponentially, wait a minute, potentially that apple tree and the future apple and the future apple trees and the future apple, and you see how it goes. God says all of it and the fullness thereof belongs to me in its potentiality. Anything that might be produced in the ages to come, who does it belong to? The fullness, it belongs to me. Where does it begin? Verse 1, the earth. So the place of Israel's future hope, number one, is the earth. The Apostle Paul, he's going to demonstrate, you know, when he addresses the Lord of glory, I'm just going to tell you because the place isn't the earth. The place is in the heavenly places. The problem, look there at verse 2, Psalms chapter 24, verse 2. For he hath founded it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Now, verse 2 is not talking about Genesis chapter 1, day number 3. On the third day, you know what God did? God created the earth. He separated the earth, the dry ground, from the water, from the sea. On day 3, God did create or separate the waters that are on the earth. But if you notice the language, the earth, according to verse 2, is upon the floods and upon... Is there a difference between the dry ground and the water separated on the earth and the earth being founded on the seas? There's a big difference. Verse 1 and verse 2 is taking the reader back to Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 and 2. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the what? the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. We commented on that last week, you know, isn't that interesting? The first mention of God, the Holy Spirit, he's coming down and he moves upon the waters. The first reference or the first activity of God, the Holy Spirit in the New Testament. Remember, he comes down as a dove and he lands upon the Lord Jesus Christ while the Lord Jesus Christ is in the water. New restoration. So there's just fascinating imagery here. But here's the point. You have the place, earth, but the problem is there are these floods. Are floods a good thing? No. Now, what is the most well-known flood in the Bible? Noah, Genesis chapter 6. Remember that? God sent the flood. Listen, there are a couple of floods that are referred to in the Old Testament. And these floods are not good. They're destructive. In fact, godly men are called floods. I mean, so God uses the term flood to represent rebellion, to represent opposition. God did something. The earth is founded upon the flood, the waters. The flood waters was a deliberate act of God's judgment and wrath against a great usurper. Real, keep your finger here. Just go to Isaiah chapter 27. When we recognize there is a problem in history, there's a problem in creation, there is a problem when we study God's purpose on the earth and for the earth. Notice Isaiah chapter 27, verse 1. Isaiah chapter 27, verse 1. In that day the Lord with his sore and great and strong sword shall punish Leviathan, the piercing serpent, even Leviathan, that crooked serpent, and he shall slay the dragon that is in the what? The sea. That's not Genesis chapter 1 and verse 13. This is Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. God established the earth upon the sea and upon the floods. And there are some passages in Psalms where God, he then gave the decree. And he commanded that the waters flee. You know what God the Holy Spirit did when he moved upon the face of the waters? He issued the verbal command. And guess what happened to the flood waters? They fled. And then God says that there is the frozen deep. These waters back there in Genesis 1, they fled by way of the command of God the Holy Spirit, the verbal command to flee, and they fled. And God now has frozen it out there in the recesses of the universe. But God will continue to use language reminding his people, there's a creature. He is a water-born creature. He's called Leviathan. He's called the crooked serpent. He's called the dragon that comes out of the sea. He's called Rahab. Rahab is a water creature. The point is this. There is a problem in the universe. He's called Satan. There's going to be a parallel with the Apostle Paul. Paul's going to talk about the world. The wisdom of this world. He's talking about the adversary. He's talking about the moral, intellectual aspect of the system and the course of this world, which is a mere reflection of the satanic policy of evil. See, when Paul develops the idea of the King of Glory, he's going to use the term Lord of Glory to add some things that you don't find in Psalms 24. Going back to Psalms 24, you have the place, verse 1. You have the problem in verse 2. And this is something I want to end with, especially. Verses 3 through verse 6. You have the people of God's future hope, which is a righteous kingdom on planet Earth. Who's the King of Glory? Five times, the King of Glory, that's Jehovah God. The King of Glory, that's a messianic title. The King of Glory, he walks into the kingdom at his second coming, and that has everything to do with second coming wrath. Hence, you have the language, strong and mighty. The Lord is mighty in battle. Psalms describes how Messiah, he has the strong arm. He's going to literally crush and break with catastrophic force all of the enemies of Israel, all of the enemies of God, all the enemies of the Son, the Lord Jesus. And he's going to walk in as the King of Glory. But there's a type of people that he's going to use. Paul does the same thing in 1 Corinthians. The people, however, aren't the same people that we read about verses 3 through verse 6 in Psalms 24. There's a new people. It's called the church, the body of Christ. We are his workmanship, created where? In Christ Jesus. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. And then we see the promise. Verse 7 through verse 10 is the promise of this future king and his kingdom, Lord Jehovah, in the person of Messiah, whom of course we know is the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul is borrowing language from Psalms 24, not to suggest it's now fulfilled, not to suggest that the Lord of glory, as the Apostle Paul refers to him, is fulfilling Psalms 24, but rather what Paul is doing, as he does quite often in his epistles, he will refer to Old Testament scripture. In fact, he will refer to the Psalms, and he'll say, you see, what you study about in Psalms in relationship to God's purpose on the earth, in relationship to God's people, Israel, spiritually regenerated Israel, spiritually reborn Israel, and their hope of a kingdom and a king on earth, you and I, in the dispensation of the grace of God, the parallel is, guess what God is doing in the heavens? Guess who he's fighting with in the heavens? It's the same adversary. Guess who God is using? The church, the body of Christ. And guess what our ultimate hope is? The promise is to be conformed into the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's why Paul is using that language. Now, what we'll do is just recognize the people. Because when Paul talks about God ordaining something for our glory, unto our glory, what God is saying is, I'm going to put you on the trophy chest. I'm going to put you on that pedestal. Not because we are worthy of being on the pedestal, but what God is going to put on open display is the wisdom of his grace and the riches of his grace that now literally makes us the awe and envy of all creation. That's our glory. What's he doing? In verse 3, who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands. You ever use that expression? Hey, my hands are clean. You know when we use that expression, what do we mean when we say, hey, my hands are clean? I didn't participate. I'm not involved in whatever dirty, deceitful work or operation or plan. So when we say, hey, my hands are clean, that means I'm not participating in this. I'm not participating in the apostasy. I'm not participating in the spiritual rebellion or the spiritual blindness or the spiritual ignorance. When God refers to those who have clean hands, oh, we also would use the expression, I wash my hands. You know how we use that expression? I wash my hands. I'm not a party to this. Remember what Pilate did? You know, whom should I let go? Barabbas, or your king, the king of the Jews. And remember what the nation of Israel demanded? We have no king but Caesar. And they demanded Barabbas. And then, of course, what does Pilate do? He takes a wash basin. And by the way, remember what Israel said? His blood be upon our shoulders. You have a Gentile king who says, but by the way, he washes his hands as a public testimony. I wash my hands of this. I'm not a party to any of this. The people, verse 4, he that hath clean hands, and a pure heart. You know what this passage is saying? These individuals who are not participating in the filth and in the dirt and in the dregs of the satanic, those people, they're the ones that are going to have the right to ascend into the holy hill. But I want you to notice the conditionality of this. Verse 7, he that hath clean hands and a pure heart, who hath not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully, he shall receive the blessing. Is this an if-then relationship? Did you notice something here? If you meet the qualification, verse 4, you meet the qualification of verse 5, or I'm sorry, if you meet the qualification of verse 4, then you receive the blessing in verse 5. Why is it important to note? That is not the type of relationship we have. When God says, I'm doing something for your glory, I'm going to put you on that stand as a public testimony of my grace on your behalf. Today in the dispensation of grace, we don't do anything to gain or to earn or to keep a blessing. I just want you to recognize there's a fascinating difference. The Lord of glory, when Paul uses the Lord of glory, he's borrowing language here, but he's going to communicate something quite different. Verse 5, he shall receive the blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Verse 4, he that hath. I just want, you have it, you'll be blessed. You have it, you'll get righteousness. Go over to Matthew chapter 5, because quite frankly, fear not, we're getting there. Matthew chapter 5. What you have Jesus Christ doing is, he's going to expand upon Psalms chapter 24. If Psalms 24 says, who gets to be a part of this kingdom? Who gets to walk up to that holy hill? Who gets to be the priesthood? Who gets to participate with Messiah? And the book of Revelation describes, you know, there's a class of Israelite that will receive white robes, and they're going to get a name, a special name, and they're going to reign and rule with Jesus Christ on that holy hill of Zion. Jesus says, you faithful people, you the remnant that survive and endure faithfully during that 7-year tribulational period, you're going to have a special place. You're going to get up there to that hill. But wait a minute, you got to have clean hands. You got to have a pure heart. Then you'll get the blessing. So Jesus Christ, he expands on all of that in Matthew chapter 5. You've heard of the Sermon of the Mount, right? Inevitably, how often do you have believers today, well-intentioned, so on and so forth? They'll keep teaching and preaching the Sermon on the Mount, the, quote, Beatitudes. I am not kidding. When my in-laws were alive, when Sherry's folks were alive, we would visit Nashville like twice a year. Tell me I'm wrong, Sherry. Every time we visited, I guarantee you, maybe 99%. You know what the sermon was about? The Sermon of the Mount. For years. It's like the Sermon of the Mount, Sermon of the Mount. The Sermon of the Mount is not written to the body of Christ today. The Sermon of the Mount has no application to the body of Christ today. Anyway, you have Jesus Christ. He now begins his public ministry on top of a mountain, the new Moses, just like Moses when his first encounter was there on the mountain. Anyway, verse 2, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, now here we go, verse 3, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Again, you see the setting is the earth, the earth, the earth. That's why when he teaches the disciples prayer, he tells these disciples, when you pray to the Father, you pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Verse 6, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The Lord of glory. When Paul makes a reference to the Lord of glory, you know what God did? He ordained something on our behalf for our glory. That is, He wants the world to be dazzled and awed by the splendor of what He's doing. You study the Sermon on the Mount, you study the Beatitudes, and you find out what the Lord of glory did for us. The King of glory has the expectation of His people doing some things to receive the blessing, doing some things to receive salvation. You know what we learn about the Lord of glory? Interestingly enough, you find, for example, there at verse 3, blessed are the poor in spirit. Look at verse 5. Blessed are the meek. You know what the Lord tells us? Who was poor in spirit? Who was broken in spirit? Who was broken in heart? Who was contrite? Who was the meek one? Isn't it, according to Philippians chapter 2, the Lord Jesus Christ? Let this mind be in you, who thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but put upon himself the form of a servant, was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself unto death, even the death. Wait a minute. Our glory has to do with Jesus Christ, who became the broken one. He became the poor in spirit. He was the meek one. Paul refers to Jesus Christ as lowly and meek. Today, our glory isn't what we do. Our glory is not our achievements. This glory has nothing to do with what we're bringing to Him. This glory, the reason the universe is going to be dazzled, is because Jesus is the one who in meekness died for our sins. This passage talks about those who mourn. Look there, for example, in verse 4. Blessed are they that mourn. You know what Paul says we're supposed to be doing? Rejoice in the Lord. And again I say, what? We're not going around mourning. Israel's got to be brokenhearted in the face of apostasy, in the face of rebellion. God says, you better be broken, and then you'll get the blessing. You know what God's putting on open display? The riches of His grace that demonstrates, my Son did something for you, and don't go around mourning. You know what we should be doing? Rejoicing. That's a false humility to go around thinking, oh, I don't deserve it. Stop it. His Son deserves it. Yeah, but you know, that's a false humility. You know what God expects from us? Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. There's no room for mourning. We read, for example, there, notice there at verse 5, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. You know what God says He ordained for our glory? You and I, we are blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. That's the glory that was ordained. The achievements of His Son, Jesus Christ. We're not going around trying to inherit the earth via meekness. No, we're already blessed in the heavenly places. Notice there, verse 6, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. You know what Paul says? Christ, who is our what? That's our glory. We glory, we're awed. Look at what our Savior did for us. That's the Lord of glory. In fact, Paul writes to the Corinthians, and he writes, he says that Jesus was made sin for us that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. That's the glory. We're the object. What do you mean? How can we be the object of awe? Just like the Northern Lights. This is beautiful. The world, the universe, will look at this new creature, the body of Christ, and they'll say, they were made the righteousness of God. That's worthy to be adored and to praise and to honor. We read there at verse 7, blessed are the merciful. You know what Paul says? God who was rich in mercy while we were yet dead in sins. You know what he's done? He's made us sit together in heavenly places at the right hand of Almighty God. The issue isn't you and I being merciful in order to get the blessing or to get the salvation. God, the Lord of glory, he has been merciful to us. We read there at verse 8. Blessed are the blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Verse 9, blessed are the peacemakers. Wait a minute. Are we going around making peace so that we can now be called the children of God? Wait a minute. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have what? Peace with God. That's God's doing. The Lord, the King of glory, has as its immediate context the messianic title of a king. And the people that are going to participate are following the mandates of the messianic kingdom. They're actually adhering to the precepts of the messianic kingdom. The Lord of glory, he does it all for us. That's what he ordained on our behalf. Our joy, our pride, and our rejoicing is the achievements of our Lord of glory, who does it all freely for us. That's what God's going to put on display. Father, again, we do thank you for your grace. We do thank you for your love. We thank you for all that our dear Savior accomplished. All while we were in rebellion, we never looked for it, we never requested it, we never demand, but rather you did it while we were incapable of even thinking it. We just thank you for that grace. We thank you for all that you freely give to us because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ. We thank you for the glory that we now are participating in because you've accomplished it for us through the Son of your, through the Son of your love, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for it in his name. Amen.